Hello everyone, welcome back for lesson 5 of the course Basics of Deep Learning. So this is a second part where we will play a little bit with embeddings. So namely, we look at a collaborative filtering task which has been made popular thanks to the Netflix Prize. So Netflix Prize was a competition quite a few years back. So it finished in 2009. It was finished in 2009, and the task was, let's see, the leaderboard. So this is a pre-Kaggle competition. Netflix gave a matrix, if you want, of with two entries, one corresponding to the user, the second one to the items. And if a given user watched a given movie, there was a number of stars given by this particular user to this particular movie. And your task was try to predict for unseen movie. What are the number of stars that this particular user will put in the matrix? So the measure of performance was root mean square error, and you needed to improve by more than 10% the algorithm which was developed in-house by Netflix. And you see that actually two teams succeeded. This one 20 minutes after submitted 20 minutes after the first one, and so the first one won the $1 million dollar prize in September 2009. So how does it relate to embeddings? At a high level, you can have a look at the algorithm, which I mean, this is a presentation of the algorithm that was done by the winning team. So this is called a matrix factorization technique. And so one way to connect this with embedding is thanks to this picture. You will build embeddings, so this is called here latent factor, for each user on each movie. So, for example, for a given movie, you can have one latent factor corresponding to is it more a movie geared toward females or toward males? And then, of course, the user, if you know it's a male or a female, you will increase the chance that the given user will like the movie depending whether you are on the right or on the left here. Same thing on this y-axis, is it an escapist movie or serious movie? And then depending on where you are as a user here, so this guy, for example, is a male who likes serious movies, so you will recommend it him Braveheart, which seems to be a serious movie for geared toward males. So you see that you are building in this way one embedding vector for your use for each user, one embedding vector for each movie, and a very simple way to do prediction for the number of stars is to take what is called the dot product. So you do component-wise multiplication of these two vectors, and if the sum of this dot product is big, then you will predict a high number of stars, otherwise a low number of stars. So why is that? Because if the sum is big, this means that all your latent factors are aligned, and meaning that you will tend to like the movie. But you don't want to build this feature vector by hand, you want to learn them. So here is how you can formalize this a little bit. You can see the matrix given to you by Netflix as a huge matrix where each row corresponds to a user, each column to a movie. So most of the user didn't watch all the movies, so this line corresponding to this particular user will be mainly empty because he didn't watch movie. But at some point you will have a number of stars corresponding to the number of stars given by this particular user to this specific movie. And you model this matrix as the dot product of a feature for your so this entry is just the scalar the dot product of this feature vector for the user and this feature vector for the movies, and you sum all the components and you obtain this. So this is what is depicted here. And now what you want to minimize is the root mean square error, so which is just the standard loss that we saw in the square loss in regression. And it's written this way, and this term, for now, we'll see it later, it's a regularization term on the W matrix. Okay. So your task will be given a partially filled matrix here. Try to predict for a given user what are the movies he or she will like by learning the proper embedding for each user on each movie. Okay, so here is how it will go. So I'm using here a small data set for movie lens. So this data set where you have 100,000 ratings from 1,000 users, these are not the exact number, if I remember well. So the exact number of movies is 1,682, and there are a bit less than 1,000 users. So the first thing you need to do is download this. The second part of the practicals, you will need to do that on a bigger data set, namely on this one, where you have 1 million movie ratings instead of the 10 times more than what we are doing here. I'm using the Pandas library of Python, so nothing to do with PyTorch here. It's just, if you don't know, Pandas is a kind of, let's say, Excel in Python, so it's very convenient when you are dealing with tabular data like this. So here you can see the five first line of my data, which are called all ratings. So you see that the user ID number 196 looked at the movie 242 and put 3 stars. We will forget about the timestamp. Then the second line of my data is the user number 186 looked at the movie 302 and put 3 stars, and so on. So each time you have a line where the first is the user ID, the movie ID, and the ratings. So you can get a mapping between the movie ID and the name, which will be more convenient for us. So here I'm doing a merge. So I'm just adding the name of the movie. So for example, here you see that I only have movie 242 on this line corresponding to the movie, which is called Kolya. Okay, so let's check that we have 100,000 ratings in total. So you can use the describe function of Pandas. So here you see that it's looking only at the column ratings, so this one, so the number of stars. So the minimum is 1, so nobody put 0 stars, and the maximum is 5, okay, then the mean is 3 something. So Okay, there are exactly five different values, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. So it's a discrete rating. You do not have half star or things like that. Let's look at user ID. So the minimum number is 1, the maximum number is 943, and there are 943 user ID. So you see that actually the user ID are the number between 1 and 943. So we will change that in a moment, but let's see at the movie ID between 1 and 1682. So again, they are numbered between 1 and 100 and 1682. So I want to do a more Pythonic way. I want to number them between 0 and the 1681. Okay, so this is what I'm doing here. I'm removing 1 to all the item ID, user ID, doing the same thing in movie names. So now, okay, the first one is number 0, then number 1, then number 2, and then number 3. So it will allows me to do it. It's a small hack here that give me a more Pythonic way of dealing with the data. The first thing I need to do is to split my data in a train and test. For this, I'm using the scikit-learn library. So, and I'm using the train test split function where I'm asking to split all my ratings. So it's working with pandas data frame and keeping 20% for the test and the remaining, so 80% for the train. Now I have user ID for the train, item ID for the train, and rating for the train, and this is for the test. So the first thing I need to check, okay, this is 80% split. So I have now 80,000 ratings for the train. And you see that I have all the users apparently, but not all the movie in my train. So because of the random split, you might end up with some movies that will never show up in the training set. So for those movies, you will not learn anything with your algorithm. So you can see that all these movies, they are probably not seen by many users, so they do not appear in the train set, only in the validation set. Okay, so let's check that everything is fine. So here, what is the meaning of this? It's the user ID number 434 looked at the movie 423 and gave 1 star. The user 338 looked at the movie 210 and gave 5 star, and so on. And you can match them with this number, which is the index. Okay. So this is the data you have access to. Now, here is what you will need to do. Namely, you will need to do a small network that will be called model dot because it's corresponding to the dot product. So for this model dot, what you will do is one embedding layer for each user. So the dimension is number of users times latent dimension. One embedding for each item, each movie. So the dimension is number of items on latent dimension. So the same as this one because the latent dimension should match when you will take the dot product. And we are adding something to get better results. We are adding a biases per user and a biases per item. So the reason for this is that You can imagine that some users are not using the same scale in the way they are noting movies. So, for example, some users tend to put high score to all the movies they are watching. Some users put lower score. So, in order to take this into account, we are adding a bias for each user, modeling this. And similarly, for movies, you have movies which are for general audience and kind of blockbuster, which are liked by a lot of people. So this one will have a high bias on movie which are not liked by a lot of people, and then they will get a lower bias. Okay, so here is again an example, the example that was given in the course, how to use layer TorchNN embedding layer of PyTorch. So here you have two batches and the number is not the same because these are random numbers. So here is here are the two embedding you should use, which are a bit better probably than the TorchNN embeddings, because I'm choosing the initialization of the weight. And the way I'm doing that, it's written here. I'm normalizing the weight by basically the size of the embedding. So I take Gaussian random variable, centered, but the variance here, it's inversely proportional to the size of the vector. So that when you are summing all the square of the component of the vector, you should obtain something roughly close to one. Okay, so of course, if your vector is longer, then you want this quantity to be, each of them to be smaller. For the zero embedding, so this will be used for the bias here. I'm just filling it with a zero, the deterministic one. Okay, so your first task here is to build the dot model. So you see that I defined the init for you for this dot model. It will take by default an embedding size of 32. Then you need to put the number of users and the number of items in order to define your embedding properly. And here you have the scaled embedding for each user, the scale embedding for each movie, and the zero embedding for the bias of each user, the zero embedding for the bias of each movie. And of course, the bias is just a scalar, so this is why you have a one here. So now, in this forward loop, you need to compute the result for a given pair of user ID and movie ID of the number of stars. So remember that the number of stars predicted by your model should be the dot product of the user embeddings and the item embeddings. So you are taking the component-wise product and summing everything, plus the user bias, plus the item bias. So you can stop the video here and complete this code here and then see if it's working well by running this few cells over there. Okay, so now you should have tested that your network is working properly on this small batch where you have a batch of size 5. Okay. Taken from the training set with the rating. So here I have the NumPy version, then I'm transforming it into tensor, putting it on the device, asking my net, which is defined here, dot model, put onto the device, this batch user tensor, batch item tensor, the prediction which are made. So the prediction at the beginning, these are random numbers, so you can get negative entries, that's completely fine. And now I mean, you have a vector of size 5 corresponding to the prediction for my first pair of batch user of user item, second pair user item, third time user item, and so on. So this is what you should obtain at this stage when I'm giving you a batch of size 5 of user ID, item ID here. The meaning of this is that the first user in this batch look at the first item in this batch, and this is the prediction given by this tuple. So now we want to do learning. So we define a loss. So this is again the regression loss. So you can check that now the loss corresponding to this prediction is given by this quantity by passing the prediction here on the batch rating tensor, which is defined over there. Okay. And so the second step for you is to code the training loop here. So the goal here is to do the training only on this small batch of size 5. So you don't need to define a data set or data loader here. You will do for 15 epochs training of your model on the batch of size 5. Okay, so you can pause the video now and code it here. Okay, so here is what I'm obtaining. And you see that the loss is decreasing, then increasing again and decreasing again. So this is because I didn't choose a proper learning rate, but I get a loss which is below 0.5 at some point before increasing again. So it seems that everything is working fine now. So now I need to do the proper training of my model, and to do that, I will use the two small functions we saw in the course. So the shuffle, in order to shuffle the pair of user ID, item ID, on corresponding ratings, and then the MIDI batch, in order to load batches on my in my network. So this is done for you, and this is one way to show you how to build your own data loader without relying on PyTorch. So again, the important part is this is taking care of the shuffling. So I'm shuffling all the indices over there, and here it's an iterator that will return batches of the size batch size specified as the first argument of my mini batch. So here I'm using a framework which is not exactly the same as what we saw so far when dealing with networks. So this is what I'm calling factorization model, and you will see that this is taken from actually a library doing a collaborative filtering. So I did simplify a bit the code, but what it's doing basically, it's building a model taking as an argument all the parameters required, so the embedding dimension, the number of iterations, number of epochs, the batch size, the learning rate here, so this is for the weight decay, the device if it's on a CPU or a GPU, but also the network. So the network you define the dot model, the number of users, the number of items on the random state. Okay. So and you see that the first thing it will do actually it's initialization. So if you do not specify a network here, it will take the dot model that you built before. So this will be the self underscore net, so the network for my factorization model. And here is the associated optimizer. So by default, I'm taking Adam on the parameter of the network with the given learning rate and with the weight decay. The loss function is always the regression loss also. And then there is a fit function, which is over there, and which works for those that are familiar with in the same fashion as in scikit-learn. So the fit method here will do the training of my network for the number of epochs, which is n iter at the beginning. So you see that here, this is the training part for epoch num until this print. So the first thing I'm doing, I'm shuffling my dataset, transforming everything into tensor, then using the mini batch here. And the mini batch is taking three tensors, the user ID, item ID, and the corresponding rating. So remember that this is the list of all the user ID, all the item ID, and the corresponding ratings for each pair. So this will return a batch of size by default 256, where this will be a vector of the user in my batch, so the first user, second user, and so on. Then the first movie, second movie, and so on. And then the batch rating is the rating given by the first user on the first movie for the first component, the rating given by the second user on the second movie for the second component, and so on. Okay? So now you need to complete this part of the code, which is exactly doing the training. So it should be very similar to what you did for overfitting. And this part of the code will be called each time you are running the fit method. So you can pause the video now and fill the missing part over there. Okay, so when you are done, I'm defining a factorization model with this default parameter. You can play with them if you want, but the number of users and number of items are fixed. You see that I will run it for 5 epochs with a big batch size. So here I'm defining my train and test dataset in NumPy, and you see that I checked that my code was valid by doing a model.fit, and it's printing for the first epoch what is the loss on the train, for the second epoch, epoch number one, the loss on the train, and so on. So it's decreasing. So the advantage is now, if I'm just running this again, I will not reinitialize the network, so you see that the loss is still increasing. So perhaps I can do it a third times. Okay. Let's see. Okay, so it looks like I'm already overfitting, because on the test set, the loss is a bit bigger. So actually, what you can do is modify the code in order to print both the training loss here and the loss on the test set over there to see when to stop. It will be much more convenient. So now, I remove the predict, so there is a bug. So I will correct this before going on. Okay, so I corrected the bug, but I didn't want to show the solution right now, so let's see if it's working. Okay, so let's go for 5 more epochs. I'm not overfitting yet. Okay, now I'm starting to overfit probably. Okay, it's working fine. So you see that I have a root mean square error of 94%. So let's see. Yes, we can improve it a little bit probably. Yeah, okay. Okay, let's stop here. If you want to have numbers to compare to, there is this website where you have benchmarks on the MovieLens dataset. So you see that we are basically achieving this performance. Okay, so now what we will do is try to sort the movie from the best one to the worst one. So I should remove this actually. So here is so how to do that is I will look, I will find the bias of each of my movie. So this is what I'm doing here. I'm asking for my network in my model, the biases of my item, and I'm recovering the weight data.cpu.numpy in order to get a NumPy version. Now I'm making a new data frame where this is the item name and this is the corresponding bias. So remember that we are adding the bias of a movie in order to get a better prediction, meaning that if the bias is high, this means that the people have a tendency to put high score to this movie. So this is what we will call the best movie. So here is what you obtain when you are sorting now the movies according to the biases. Okay, so the top 10 is over there. So not surprisingly, you have quite famous and well-appreciated movies. And here are the worst movies. So yes, which are, I don't know any of them actually. So you need to check if they are bad or not. Okay, the last thing I want to show you is what we saw in the course about the principal component analysis of the movies. So in order to get a representation in 2D of the movie, so now what I'm doing is I'm taking the latent factor of each movie. So this is done here. I'm recovering the embedding weight. So for each of the movie, I have 1,682 movie. I'm recovering a vector of size 50 because I did a training with an embedding size of 50. Now I'm again using principal component analysis from scikit-learn to decompose this huge matrix in a matrix of size 1,682 times three components only. So I want to keep the components explaining most of the shape of this matrix. Okay, so this is done here with this fit transform. And now you can see the movie according to each, sorted according to each direction of the latent factor. So here I took the first latent factor, and you see that this is what you obtain with the highest score in this latent factor on the movie that you obtain with the lowest score in this factor. So if you want to change the latent factor, perhaps take the first one, you get this one and this one. So it's not very convincing, at least for me. So this seems to be like, yes, this seems to be very kind of classical movies, while this one apparently are not. And let's see for the okay, so here you see that it's not completely clear how to understand this, but these are more probably romance movie, and these are more action movie like Braveheart. So if you want to get better results, actually you should learn on a larger data set. So now I'm making a plot corresponding to the one I showed you before of a projection of my movies according to the two first, so direction 0 and direction 1 of my latent vector. So okay, here you have some action movie, Men in Black, Return of the Jedi, Aliens. So you see that the results are not that interpretable. The reason being that your dataset is very small, and you should probably deal with a bigger dataset. So this is what I've done in order to get the picture shown to you in the course. And this is what you will need to do in the second part of the practical. The last point is that the code is inspired from this Spotlight library, which uses PyTorch to build recommender models. And you can have a look at the code over there. Actually, it will give you a solution to this practical. The bilinear net is over there. So the forward, I will not go through. Okay, very shortly here. And if you click on explicit here, this is a explicit factorization model which I took as inspiration for the code today. And you see that here I have the init, which is very similar to horse. The initialization, which is a bit more complex, but you are defining your network over there, your optimizer over there, your loss, and so on. And then the fit method, which also will give you the solution to the today's practical, where I'm using shuffle version here and mini batch here. So now this is the solution to what we did so far, and that's it. So thank you, and have fun with the second part of the practicals.